the native Nikon Z macro lens has finally arrived. And Nikon is not just releasing one macro lens, but they are releasing two macro lenses at the same time. So in this video, we are going to have a look at the new Nikon Z MC50 2.8 macro lens, and also the Nikon Z MC105 2.8 VRS macro lens at the same time. So we are going to have a look at the design, the build quality, the image quality, and I will also talk about which of these two macro lens is the better macro lens for you. Kia ora, good morning everyone, Richuan here. Welcome back to the channel. Today we are going to have a look at these two new macro lenses from Nikon. You may wonder why Nikon is releasing two macro lenses at the same time. Well, at least I had that question when I first heard about these two new lenses. But after using these two lenses side by side for a little while, I think I may have the answer. But first, let's talk about the design of these two lenses first. The build quality of this 105mm macro lens is very nice and it feels very solid. It is a weatherproof lens, and the size of this lens, if you look at it like this, you see this is not a small lens at all. The weight of this lens is 630 grams, so it's also not a very lightweight lens. But I actually don't really mind the weight and the size of the lens, because when you are shooting macro photos, the handheld macro photos, the extra weight and size of this lens would make it a little bit more steady when you try to do some handheld macro photos. This is also a VR lens, so it should help make your handheld shot more stable. And if you are using it with a body that doesn't have the IBIS, for example the Z50, the VR would be very, very important. There are two switches on the lens. One is the autofocus manual focus switch, and the other is a focus limiter. And there are two rings on the lens. One is the focus ring, and there's also a customizable ring near the lens mount. And there is a very nice OLED display, which is something that I really love about these Nikon Z lenses. And two buttons next to it, one is to change what you are going to display on the OLED display, and the other is a customizable button. This 105mm macro lens is an internal focus lens, which means when you are changing the focus distance, the size, or I should say the length of this lens wouldn't change. Okay, now let's have a look at this 50mm macro lens. The size of this lens is a lot smaller compared to the 105mm macro lens, and it is also a lot lighter at only 260 grams. The build quality of this lens is also very good, but it does feel a little bit more plasticky compared to the 105mm macro lens. But despite it feel a little bit more plasticky, it still has the metal lens mount, and it is still a weatherproof lens. Just like the 105mm macro lens, there are also two switches on the lens. One is the autofocus manual focus switch, and the other one is the focus limiter. But unlike the 105mm macro lens, it doesn't have that very nice OLED display. It doesn't have that customizable button. There's only one ring on the lens. It doesn't have that separate dedicated customizable ring, but you can customize the manual focus ring if you want to use it to control something else instead. One interesting design about this lens is, at the center of this lens, there is a ring that you can remove. And this is the ring that you can attach a 46mm filter onto it. And the reason why there's such a special design is, Nikon want to keep the size of this lens as compact as possible, so it is not an internal focus lens. What that means is, when you change the focus distance, when you try to focus closer, the center part of the lens would actually extrude. So it is quite interesting that Nikon do it this way, because usually it's the whole lens would extrude, but for this lens it's only the center part that would extrude. And because of that, so Nikon put this small filter thread here at the center for you to attach a 46mm filter onto this lens. When you shut down the camera, the center part of the lens would automatically retract into the body. With this 50mm macro lens, you can also purchase the optional ES2 digitizing adapter set, which allow you to scan 35mm film very easily. If this is the first time that you buy a macro lens, you may notice that even though these two macro lenses are both f2.8 maximum aperture macro lens, but when you are taking close-up or macro photos, the maximum aperture is no longer f2.8. It may become f4 or even f5.6, and you may wonder why. Is it because Nikon is lying to us? It's not actually a f2.8 lens? And the answer is no, and it just has something to do with something called effective aperture. So this is something that I can make a whole video and talk about, but basically, when the focus distance is getting closer and closer and the magnification is getting higher and higher, the effective aperture would become smaller and smaller. This is completely normal, and it is the same for pretty much every single macro lens in the market. And this is very similar for the minimum aperture that you can use. For the 50mm lens, the minimum aperture is f22, while the 105mm lens is f32. But when you are shooting one-to-one magnification photos, then the minimum aperture for the 50mm lens now is f32, while the minimum aperture for the 105 lens is f51. Both of these macro lenses using stepping autofocus motor. The autofocus operation is very smooth and also pretty fast as well. The 105mm lens autofocus noise is slightly more quiet compared to the 50mm lens, but I would say both lenses, the autofocus noise, they are both very, very quiet. When taking macro photo at 1-to-1 magnification, with the 50mm lens, the minimum working distance, which means the front of the lens to the subject that you are shooting, is only around 4 to 5 centimeters, so it's pretty close to your subject. In comparison, the 105mm lens, the minimal working distance when you are taking 1-to-1 magnification photo is quite a bit longer at around 13 centimeters or so. So that means if you want to take some macro photos of some insects or animals, the 105mm lens would probably be a easier choice because you don't have to get so close to your subject, and also there's a less chance that you'll be casting shadow on your subject. Okay, now let's have a look at the image quality, and as usual, let's start with the image sharpness first. Look at the center of the photo. Even at the maximum aperture f2.8, both lenses are very sharp. But if I compare them side by side, the 105mm macro lens is a bit sharper than the 50mm lens. Now, if we look at the corner, with the 50mm lens at the maximum aperture f2.8, the corner is a little bit soft. But if you look at the 105mm lens, then the corner, even at the maximum aperture, is still very sharp. I would say crazily sharp for the corner at its maximum aperture. With the 50mm lens, you will need to stop down to around f5.6, then the corner sharpness also become excellent. And if you look at the photo that I shot at 1-to-1 magnification, even at the maximum aperture, both lenses' center sharpness are excellent. But you probably would stop down the lens quite a bit anyway because the depth of field is so narrow when you are shooting at maximum aperture. For macro lenses, the out-of-focus area rendering is very important, and not surprisingly, both of these Nikon macro lenses render the out-of-focus area very beautifully. The bokeh is very soft and very dreamy, and even when you stop down the lens, the bokeh balls are still very rounded and very nice. The 105mm macro lens with its longer focal length can melt the background easier than the 50mm lens. However, I do notice with this 105mm lens, when you are shooting close-up subject at the maximum aperture, the bokeh balls near the corner or the edge of the frame could be crimped a little bit, and there's also a little bit cat's eye effect, which is something that I don't really notice with the 50mm lens. Color fringing is very well controlled by these two lenses. Look at these test photos. The sun was behind and slightly above the house, so usually it means there could be quite a bit of color fringing near the top of the roof. But if we zoom in and look at these photos, even with the Z7II's high resolution 46 megapixel sensor, I can only see quite a small amount of chromatic aberration. And next, let's have a look at these local test photos. Both of these photos were shot at 1:1 magnification at the maximum aperture. I can see almost no color fringing at all, especially the photo that shot with the 105mm lens. So that is definitely very impressive. And just for a quick comparison, this is a photo that I shot with my Nikon AFS 16mm f2.8 macro lens. So it is easy to see that there is quite a bit more color fringing, especially the green fringing in the background. In terms of distortions, even with the distortion correction turned off, if you look at these brick wall test photos, the amount of distortion is at a very, very minimal level. In terms of SUNSTARS, I think the aperture rates on both of these lenses are not really optimized for SUNSTARS. When stopped down the lens, there isn't any sharp or nice looking SUNSTARS from both of these lenses. Even when I stop all the way down to the minimum aperture, the SUNSTARS are probably just okay. So these are not the lenses that I would pick if I want to capture some nighttime cityscape photos with some beautiful SUNSTARS. The 105mm macro lens has the nano coating as well as an anneal coating, so the lens flare control definitely didn't disappoint me. Even when shooting directly into the sun, the amount of lens flare and ghosting is at a very, very low level. With the 50mm lens, Nikon didn't mention anything about the nano coating or the anneal coating, but surprisingly, the lens flare control is actually very well, and I would even say it seems to be slightly better than the 105mm lens, because look at this test shot that I directly shoot into the sun. The amount of lens flare is at such a low level. With the 105mm macro lens, vignetting is not really serious even at the maximum aperture. When stopped down to f4, it would already remove most of the vignetting, and at f5.6, then vignetting is not really noticeable at all. With the 50mm lens, the amount of vignetting is very similar to the 105mm lens, so it's not really serious even at the maximum aperture, and I would say the 50mm lens is even slightly better than the 105mm lens when taking photo at the same aperture setting. In terms of focus breathing, if you look at this test footage, you can see that both these lenses have pretty strong focus breathing, but this is pretty normal for most macro lenses. Okay, now to answer the question, which of these two macro lens is the better macro lens for you? I think if you are someone who is really concerned about the image quality, then I would pick the 105 macro lens, because the image quality of this lens is just excellent. The image sharpness from the center all the way to the edges, even at the maximum aperture, it is just so sharp. It is insanely sharp. And also pretty much everything else, from the bokeh to vignetting, chromatic aberration, lens flare, everything is pretty much as good as I can imagine it could be. The 50mm lens is also very good. Don't get me wrong, it is also a very good lens. But in comparison to the 105mm lens, the 105mm lens is just a better lens in terms of image quality. But if you ask me, I would probably not choose which lens is the better lens using the image quality, because even though I say the 50mm lens is not as good as the 105mm lens, it is still good enough, because even when I test with the Z7II, I think I'm still very happy with the image quality from the 50mm lens. So for me, instead of just looking at the image quality, I would consider other things, for example, what sort of lenses that I already have. So for example, if you already have the 24-70 f4 lens, which is a pretty compact lens, then I would most likely get the 105mm lens instead. And the reason is, first, the focal length is a little bit different from your 24-70mm lens, so it is a slightly longer lens, so it doesn't overlap the focal length, so you can use it as a short telephoto lens, you can use it as a portrait lens, so it's just something that is a little bit different to your 24-70 f4 lens. But on the other hand, if you don't have the 24-70 f4 lens, or you don't have any more compact lenses and you want to have a smaller compact lens that you can maybe use it as your everyday lens as well, then the 50 2.8 lens would be a fantastic choice for you, because the lens, the size and the weight of this lens is so small, so I would be really happy to just carry it with me as an everyday lens on my camera, and then you can also use it to shoot some macro photos when you want to. So yeah, if you don't have any compact lens, then I think the 50mm lens would be a very, very good choice instead. And another thing that I would also consider is what kind of macro photos that you want to take. Is it photos of something that doesn't really move, for example, some flowers or some plants? Or is it something that would move, for example, insects, spiders, or some animals? If you want to take macro photos of some living objects, then the 105mm lens would be better for you, because the minimal working distance is quite a bit longer, so you could stay a little bit further away from your subject, and also because it is an internal focus lens, so the front element wouldn't extrude when you are changing focus, so you wouldn't have to worry about the front element suddenly get too close to your subject, which could happen with this 50mm lens. And that's one more thing that I would consider. That is something that I don't hear a lot of people talking about. It is the focal length. The 50mm and 105mm is quite a big difference in terms of the focal length. And what that means is the field of view is quite different. Look at these two photos that the subject is at pretty much same size, but you can see the background that capture using the two different lenses are quite different. With the 50mm lens, the field of view is quite a bit wider, so that means you capture quite a bit more or quite a bit wider background in your photo, while the 105mm lens, it has a more narrow field of view, so yeah, the background is quite a bit narrow. So it's not like one is better than the other, it's just like, think about the macro photo that you want to take, what sort of background do you want to have, more background, maybe then you can tell a little bit more story, because you want to tell, for example, where do you take this macro photo, or you want to have a very narrow field of view so you don't have too much distraction in the background, then the 105mm lens would be the better lens for you. So what do you guys think about these two lenses, and which one is the lens that you would choose for your Nikon Z camera? Let me know, drop a comment below, I'll be interested to see which of these two lenses is the more popular macro lenses for Nikon shooters.